Hello. This talk is about TLS 1.3. I'm Daiki Ueno, working in Red Hat crypto team. So I set the audience level to intermediate, so I assume everyone is already familiar with at least TLS. TLS 1.3 is a successor of TLS 1.2. It was published in last August after 4 years of development. It has three sales points: low latency, and more security, and cleaner protocol. So, low latency. Today, TLS clients are commodity. You probably have smartphones. It has web browsers and a bunch of applications are talking TLS under the hood. So the server need to handle a number of connections at a time. So that means even computational power is increasing. The internet is getting slower. So avoiding unnecessary latency is quite important. So in TLS 1.2, to start the communication, it required two round trips. It was reduced into single round trip in TLS 1.3. It makes a big difference when connecting to the server on the initial time. And more security. You know, every crypto algorithms has its own lifetime. So TLS 1.3 dropped all the insecure algorithms. And in particular, it only allowed AAD ciphers when doing some symmetric encryption. So there are a lot of protocol cleanups in the protocol design, but I can show you two of them. One is cipher suites, and another is session resumption. So TLS 1.2, there are over 100 of cipher suites can be used. That's because a cipher suite consists of four components. One is key exchange, cipher algorithm, and MAC algorithm, and hash. But in TLS 1.3, it's reduced to five because key exchange algorithm is moved to a different place of a protocol, and cipher and MAC algorithms are combined into one because we only allow AAD algorithm. So session resumption. In TLS 1.2, to resume the previously established connection, server need to keep track of the session ID and store the session parameters into some database. So server needs to be stateful in that sense. In TLS 1.3, it only allows session resumption with session ticket. Session ticket is a mechanism that packs the security parameters into opaque data and encrypt it and send it to client. Then, when resuming, client sends it back to server, and server can decrypt it and use the security parameters. That effectively means server can use the client as an external database. So TLS 1.3 is good. So how can I use TLS 1.3? Actually, it is already enabled in major libraries. OpenSSL is popular in server applications. WinTLS is used in GNOME, and NSS used by some modular applications. And so if you are using TLS 1.2, in a normal way, you don't need to code. But TLS 1.3 added some new features. So that's needs new API to use it. So new features are like this four. Maybe there are more, but yeah, I can use these four examples. So before looking into the actual APIs, I'd like to think a bit about what is a good API. Some people might say the important factor is usability, and others might say flexibility is more important. The usability is basically the library should be easy to use and hard to misuse. To achieve that, a common strategy is doing Huffman coding based on design pattern, based on usage patterns. That is to require writing less code for common use cases and require writing more code for uncommon or potentially insecure use cases. So this is about security libraries. It is also important to make the default behavior to be safe. The flexibility. So common TLS libraries don't have any specific target. It can run on some embedded small devices, or it can run on powerful servers in data center. So it is to cover those all the different use cases, it is important to decouple external resource access from the code itself. And someone probably suggests add callbacks in any code path, so it would provide more flexibility. And also, TLS 1.3 is not the final version of TLS. There will be probably TLS 1.4 in 10 years. So we can't assume parameters to be fixed. Those usability and flexibility often don't compromise. So we need to find some trade-off. So let's look at the existing design choices of our selected libraries. So first IO abstraction, whether the library have any generic IO which can be used for both TLS and non-TLS connections, and handshake process, whether you need to call some special function to trigger handshake, or it is implicitly done. And finally, how resumption data is tracked. It is automatically or manually. So this is the table. You can see OpenSSL and NSSL share the same similar principles that basically do that for you automatically. But GNU TLS seems to be a bit more manual. You need to write some more code to make your applications work. So let's look into the new APIs. So post-handshake authentication. This is to allow the server to request client authentication at any time. This is typically used in HTTP web servers to request client authentication at the actual to delay the client authentication until the resource is actually requested. So OpenSSL and GNU TLS provides two functions for these purposes. That is, in the client side, to indicate the client supports post-handshake authentication, and in the server side, to request client authentication. Unfortunately, NSS doesn't support it yet, and it is being worked on. So key update. So every symmetric encryption algorithm have its own limit of the maximum amount of data which can be safely encrypted using the same key. So you need, want to reuse the connection for a long time, you need to update the key dynamically. So TLS 1.3 added special message key update in the protocol. So, and GNU-TLS and NSS does the key update automatically. But it can also be done with explicit API. These all libraries provide the similar functions like this. Okay. So length hiding. So if your attacker can monitor your traffic, so it can probably guess the length of the actual plain text. So if you are transferring some series of files, it might be obvious to the attacker which files you are sending. So to prevent this, TLS 1.3 added some way to make it larger. Okay. So in OpenSSL, it has two ways of doing this. One is SSL set block padding. It makes any packet can be a multiple of specified block size. It can be overridden with custom callback. So it can do random padding if you want. So GNU-TLS chose the different way, that is to add new send function that takes a padding parameter. So it is simpler, but it only applies to application data records. In OpenSSL, it can apply to any other messages, like handshake or alert. And NSS doesn't have it yet. So zero RTT. So as I said before, TLS 1.3 can complete the handshake with single round trip, but it can be even zero round trip. That is, when resuming, the client can send the application data encrypted with the previously shared key. So it brings even lower latency. So sending zero RTT data is typically done in three steps. One is to check the maximum amount of data that the server would accept, then send the early data, and lastly, check if the server has accepted it. If not, it can resend the data as one RTT. So in OpenSSL, it's quite straightforward. Check the maximum amount, send it, and check the status and resend it if it failed. This is also GNU-TLS. Yeah, it's similar, but it needs to call handshake function manually. This is NSS. This is kind of similar, but the point is it only uses this PR send function for both zero RTT data and normal application data. Okay? So in the receiving side, actually, there are some risks. Because zero RTT data is encrypted using the key derived from the previous session. So there is no forward secrecy. So, and also, if the attacker duplicate the previous client hello, it can resend the same data to the server. So all those libraries provide some measures to this replay attacks. OpenSSL uses the method called single-use tickets, and GNU-TLS and NSS use client hollow recording. A single use tickets is quite powerful mechanism. That is simply record all the session ticket issued and check if it is not reused. It is not limited to 0RTT, but usually session ticket has a longer lifetime, like 1 week. So the problem is this problem of this approach is database can be bigger and bigger. On the other hand, client hello recording tries to record the client hello message, not the session ticket itself. And it records in a very small time window. So, and it can roll back, roll over the database when certain time is elapsed. So receiving is basically in these two steps. Enable 0RTT with anti-play. All those libraries reject by default the 0RTT data, even it is, if it is not configured with anti-play. And accept or reject early data. So this is OpenSSL example. It's just enable the 0RTT. It's actually enabled by default. And so it's quite simple that so and call the new function, read early data in a loop before handshake is started. Going to this is a bit complicated. First enable the early data in the initialization, and then set up the anti-replay mechanism with some non-default parameters. And you need to add some callback to if you want to use some external database. It is not all. To receive, you need to set up a hook function that is called during handshake. And in the hook function, you can call receive early data function. Yeah. In NSS, it also uses client hello recording, but the API is quite simple because it is using Bloom filter data structure instead of database. So this is simpler, but it has a drawback because the Bloom filters are per process, so it cannot be deployed in distributed server settings. So, summary. TLS 1.3 is much better than TLS 1.2. TLS 1.3 also brings some new features. Those features require new API to access. And you already seen, already have seen some of the APIs look a bit strange, but API designs have some reasons behind them. So don't blame the developers and read the documentation. So any questions?
Any guidance on when we should enable the identifying stuff?
Sorry?
Any guidance on when we should enable identifying?
not really, but name siding is quite application specific in the protocol design, actually, because it cannot be the removal of padding cannot be constant time because there is no length field. So, it depends on your application protocol, actually.
Is NSS going to get the additional features at some point?
Yes. Yes, and you can propose at any point, actually, because NSS APIs are currently marked as experimental and not part of the official API set. So yeah, we can propose at any time.
What do you think about adoption of 1.3? Because still a lot of legacy systems not upgraded to 1.1, etc. Are you kind of a bit trying to enforce that?
Yeah, to communicate with legacy systems, I think those libraries have some mechanism to configure the library with only lower versions of the protocols. But TLS 1.3 itself has some downgrade mechanism. So, yeah, it would be supported.
TLS 1.3 also have downgrade protection mechanism, not just downgrade.
So, anything else? So if not, thanks everyone for coming.